I have wooden birds in my house.
The main message we would like to tell the world is that we are many initiatives from many countries that are coming together to try to break the siege of Gaza as one international flotilla, working together to assert the right of the people of Gaza to freedom and to the end of the blockade of Gaza that has been announced illegal by many international entities, and that the world should not be silent about, and that if governments and world authorities are silent about it, we as citizens of the world will not be silent about it. We will speak up against it and do whatever we can with whatever means we can to end the blockade and to deliver much needed help to the people of Gaza, both in material, but more importantly in a political message that this blockade should not exist. The meeting in Amsterdam is the last meeting, I mean, not up to now, the last one of a long series of meetings to coordinate together between now about 13 or 14 international initiatives from different countries, from different places, coming together to really show that they can coordinate their work to have a stronger impact on the effort to break the siege of Gaza. Each meeting is a progress from the meeting before. We are putting in place the plans to be able to effectively challenge and voice our objection to the blockade. The exact outcome of each meeting, I would rather keep it to ourselves at this point. Egypt is my homeland. I'm originally Egyptian. Okay. I've been living in Canada for over 20 years, but I'm originally Egyptian. I'm very proud of the Egyptian people now that rose up and stood up against the oppression and against the dictatorship. And I never wore a scarf with Egypt when Egypt won football matches or won the African Cup. I'm putting on the scarf of Egypt now for the last month and a half because I'm really proud of what the Egyptian people do. And it really links with the project I've been putting a lot of my life into for the last year, which is the Canadian boat to Gaza and the international flotilla, that it's all a fight for freedom and people sacrificing for what they believe is justice and what they believe is the right of people to live in dignity and get out of the oppressive systems that control them. I would like to first say that the relationship is on many levels between what the people in Egypt are doing and the problem in Gaza. The physical connection, which is the tunnels or the border crossing, is only one of them. And yes, we were always, as Egyptian people, forget the Egyptian government, we were always ashamed to a certain extent of what we are doing to the people of Gaza. I don't want to just say our Palestinian brothers and sisters, the human people, forget the ethnic or religious ties. Any country should not participate in the torture and the oppression of a people the way this blockade is doing to the people of Gaza. So it was a very shameful thing that Egypt had closed its borders with Gaza. And the other thing, the tunnels were never a solution. The tunnels are creating a black market economy in Gaza. But they're the only solution. The people of Gaza were forced, and the people those in Egypt, some of them were doing it out of care of the people of Gaza, others were doing it as a trade, as an industry to make money. This is not a solution. The tunnels are not a solution. The borders should be opened. So we hope that with the evolution of the free system in Egypt, that the government of Egypt would refuse to participate in this blockade and would open its borders between Egypt and Gaza. Yet, this is not the only connection, and this will not be a solution. Israel should remove the blockade. The blockade is enforced by Israel, and Israel should be pressured, if it doesn't do it voluntarily, should be pressured to end this blockade. But also, the movement in Egypt has another very important factor, is that the rise of the people's power, the rise of the people's influence on the political system is a very strong sign to the whole people of the world that this, if it happens in one place, Tunisia, Egypt, it can happen anywhere and it should happen anywhere. This is a more important influence. It gives energy to the people working for justice and working for human rights to continue working, and nothing is impossible. I, as an Egyptian, one day for many years thought that the Egyptian people will never rise, and that this new generation in Egypt that is newer than my generation have grown up under such an oppressive system that they don't know what it means to try to fight for their freedom. And they did. And this is such a huge message. It, to me, it's exactly like the first Intifada in Palestine in the late 80s, when we saw that it was the young people who were born under occupation after 20 years after the occupation of 67 were the ones who led the Intifada on the streets. You can't kill the human spirit. And that's the message what happened in Egypt gives, or reminds, it doesn't give it because it has been given so many times throughout history. But what happened in Egypt reminds the world of this. You cannot kill the human spirit. Not a generation, not two generations, not 10 generations of oppression will kill the human spirit. It makes people believe that every injustice has a point to end. And that, in my opinion, above the direct contact with Gaza and above the change in the political systems of the Arab world, which would also influence the political situation with Israel as well. But the rise of the spirit is more important than everything else. First, I mean, as an Egyptian not living in Egypt from the very beginning of the Intifada, and although like in Canada, we did a lot of actions and movements and demonstrations, and we went and lobbied at the consulate and at the embassy of Egypt to support the revolution, but we don't want to tell them what they should do or what they should ask for. It is the people on the ground inside Egypt who know, and they seem to know very well. They don't need what I think, really. The great things they are doing is that Mubarak out was only one of the goals, and I think it was a practical goal more than an emotional goal, because they understood very clearly that change will not happen if this head of system that's controlling everything doesn't go. But this was, they seem to be very well planned and strategized. This was only one step. What really is needed in Egypt is change in the political system itself, is a real democracy, is like no remnants of the old regime would stay. And just 2-3 days ago, they finally managed to kick out the prime minister that Mubarak had appointed. And now they are after 3 key ministers, and then after the law, the emergency law. So again, they don't need us to tell them what to do. There are dangers. It seems that the people on the street, supported by the vast majority of the Egyptian population, are very clear on what needs to be done and are very adamant to get it done. The sacrifice they had, like lives and blood, is not the only sacrifice. They are continuing to sacrifice their effort and their time, and I'm sure they're willing to sacrifice more, whatever they need to get the system resolved. So they know, and we support. We support them, and we do whatever we can from the outside to help them. But it's their real work that will make the change, not ours. So we should just salute them, not tell them what they should do. What the people in the West should do is not let their governments run the show unchecked. We have witnessed and are witnessing a surge of, I don't care if it's right wing or left wing. Tony Blair was supposed to be on the left, but he did a lot of them. So I'm not going to talk right and left wing politics. The politicians in the West pay lip service to human rights, but then pay real importance and are real slaves to financial interests and geopolitical interests of their countries. What they believe is that the people should tell the governments that our interest is not only to find material, food and clothes, and it's also to see a world that's just. Because you know what? It's a real interest for the people. It's not just a theoretical thing. If the world, the more injustice there is in the world, the more it's going to affect everybody. And it does. It will come back to create a world that's unstable, and then it affects everybody. So the solution is to create a stable world. And there is enough resources in the world to have everybody live comfortably. If the greed and looking for our interest, but we don't care about them, ends, or at least is checked all the time. And that's the message to the people of the West. The message is, we, as citizens of Western countries, as long as we benefit economically and in lifestyle from the oppression of other people, we have a role to play. We ourselves, and that role it's to play is against our own governments, to tell them, no, don't just ignore the suffering of other people elsewhere. And again, maybe it will happen soon that we should rise in a higher voice against our own governments if they don't do that. If in Egypt they were saying the people want the change of the regime, maybe what we need is a reform of the regimes in the West. Maybe not the change as in the same sense, but the whole mentality we are living under is going back, coming back to haunt us, and we shouldn't accept that.